It's always a pleasure to meet other book lovers, and of course we have the most fabulous story and the most wonderful author. I met John about a month ago. He actually is living in the same neighborhood of a very good friend of mine, and so he was very kind and attended our book group in Vancouver. And John hails from Boston, as you know, and he came here to BC because his wife is an anthropology person working in anthropology to do a PhD, wasn't it?
Did a master's.
Did her master's, yeah. Right. And so they fell in love with BC, and in his travels he came upon the story about the golden spruce. Didn't get a chance to see the tree, but saw, you know, the cutting of the tree, and it took this wonderful man to bring this story together for all of us so that we could enjoy the history of BC, all the information about the Haida Indians and culture, and this interesting man. So we have a story about a man and a story about a tree, and I think you would all join me in welcoming John.
Well, I'm really thrilled to be here on several different levels. first of all, I'd really like to thank Paula for just getting excited and making it happen. And it doesn't happen all that often in the book world, and so when it does, it is much appreciated. And so I can, your enthusiasm, as you said of me, same to you, is palpable down south there, and putting this together, and also just, you know, this is a really appropriate spot. This walking in here, my first sense, you know, this is a temple. You know, it really is, and it's. This is a beautiful way to use wood.
Yeah.
You know, this is, you can just, it's like drinking your whiskey straight. You know exactly what you're getting. It's a beautiful thing. So really, really honored to be here with you in this amazing spot.
Would you like to start with a reading, or would you like to start with a discussion about your book, or?
I'd love to read if you're into that.
Yeah,
you know, I guess, it is something I really. I actually didn't bring a book with me. So I was hoping there might be an extra. When I wrote this, I was thinking about music, and the. So I wrote it that way. I wrote it really to be read aloud, and I know people don't do that much these days, but. That's how I think, and that's how I read to myself. I'm quite a slow reader because I read aloud to myself, so I'm really noticing the tones and the cadence and the pauses, and I'm trying to hear and feel that. And so that's what was going through my mind as I was writing this. And also, there's I really feel when you're dealing with. Well, I think, you know, as a writer, you really have to rise to the level of the material. You know, and that's really what the aspiration is. You know, you're dealing with creation, and there's no way you can really match it. And so all you can do is try your best to render it honestly. I had a couple of different passages in mind, and I'm just going to start with this first one here. On the northwest coast, there is no graceful interval between the ocean and the trees. The forest simply takes over where the tide rack ends, erupting full-blown from the shallow, boulder earth. The boundary between the two is unstable, and the sea will heave stones, logs, and even itself into the woods at every opportunity. In return, the roots of shore pine and spruce grope for a purchase on rocks better suited to limpets and barnacles, while densely needled boughs cast shadows over colonies of starfish and sea anemones. The air is at once rank and loamy with the sweeping smells of rotting seaweed and decaying wood. From the beach, you can see as far as height and horizon will allow, but turn inland, and you will find yourself blinking in a darkened room, pupils dilating to fill the claustrophobic void. The trail of a person or the thread of a story is easily lost in such a place. Even the trees, swaddled in moss and draped in ferns, appear disguised. A coastal forest can be an awesome place to behold, huge, holy, and eternal feeling, like a branched and needled Notre Dame. But for a stranger, it is not a particularly comfortable place to be. You can be 20 paces from a road or a beach and become totally disoriented. Once inside, there is no future and no past, only the sodden twilight now. Underfoot is a leg-breaking tangle of roots and branches, and every 50 feet or so, your way is blocked by moss-covered walls of fallen trees that may be taller than you and hundreds of feet long. These so-called nurse logs will in turn have colonnades of younger trees growing out of them, 50 years old and as orderly as pickets. In here, boundaries between life and death, between one species and the next, blur and blend. Everything is being used as a launching pad by something else. Everyone wants a piece of the sky. And down below, the undergrowth is thick, and between this and the trees, it is hard to see very far. The sound of moving water is constant, and the ground is as soft and spongy as a sofa with shot springs. You have the feeling that if you stop for too long, you will simply be grown over and absorbed by the slow and ancient riot of growth going on all around you. It can be suffocating, and the need to see the sun can become overpowering, something you could do easily if it weren't for all those trees.
Thank you.